Revelation, as I've said before, is the principal book of prophecy in the New Testament of the Bible.
Gerald Fleury.
Greetings, everyone. Last week, I talked to you about our awesome universe potential, and it is truly awesome. We have the Hubble telescope that's orbiting the Earth and sending us all these fabulous pictures of the universe like we've never, ever seen before. And many scientists say it's the most important development in the last century. The Hubble telescope, of course, sees much farther into the universe than all of the land-based telescopes. For example, 5 years after Hubble was launched, the land-based telescope saw a little speck in the sky. Now, that would have been about 4 billion times fainter than what the human eye could see. They saw that speck in the sky on these land-based telescopes, and then they focused the Hubble telescope on that speck. After a short while, they discovered that there, in that little speck, there were 3,000 galaxies, with each one having an average of 200 billion stars, and many of those stars, like our sun, but most of them are enormously bigger than our sun. Now, you can prove that God created that universe. When we say that, we're not fantasizing, but we're telling you that God has given you a formula, and if you follow that formula, you will be able to prove that to yourself and have not a shadow of doubt about it. That's a promise from God. And you'll be more inspired than you've ever been in your life. Because how could you understand that and not be uplifted and moved and stirred by it? The great men of the Bible were able to give up their lives, sacrifice their lives for God, because they saw that vision and they had proven it to themselves. Abraham saw a city whose builder and maker is God. And that city was the one that God the Father is going to bring to this earth after there are no more human beings, only the members of God's family. And that's everybody except those who just reject God and don't want anything to do with God. But imagine that vision of seeing way beyond the earth and the millennium and all the way down to that time when God the Father brings this new Jerusalem to this earth. Now, he saw that, and you can see it. You can see it as Abraham did. You have the same tools to see that with. Let me read you a quote from our booklet on your awesome universe potential. Quote, one well-known example is the Earth's distance from the sun. It is just right to keep temperatures here hospitable. Somewhere between 30 below zero and 120 degrees Fahrenheit. If we were farther away, we would freeze. If we were closer to the sun, we would roast. It's just right. Now, isn't that amazing? It happens to be just right to keep us from, well, freezing or burning to death. And then this article continues, each year we recognize more of these finely tuned features that allow for life here. we couldn't have this life if we didn't have these features. But in 1988, Dr. Hugh Ross's team of astronomy researchers counted 15 features that had to be just so for any life to survive. Then they went on in 91 and they added two more. 95, they added nine more. 1998, they had risen to 34 features. And by 2004, 77 features. By 2005, and on down to 2006, 140 features, all perfectly lined up so life can exist on this planet. They just keep finding more and more features that are just right for us to have life on this planet. And we couldn't otherwise. The Earth is just the perfect distance from the sun and the moon. Without our moon, the Earth would just experience catastrophic climate changes. And there wouldn't be a climate there to produce our food for life. Is that just happenstance? Was that just an accident? Did that evolve? You need to think about that deeply and study into it deeply, because there is an irrefutable proof to all of that. And it's not just an accident or an evolution. It is not that, and you can prove it. The Earth has just the right amount of water to preserve human life. It says in Hebrews 1 and verse 3 that Jesus Christ is upholding the universe by the word of His power, the word of power. That's how it all continues. And then in Psalm 75, verse 3, here's what it says. When the earth totters and all its inhabitants, it is I who keep steady its pillars. See, God holds together and sustains the universe. It could easily somehow go out of orbit unless there were these laws there and that power sustaining all that, and just so many laws that you can't even count them. And yet, scientists often overlook most of them. King David said that only the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. He was out there herding his sheep and looking up in the night watches at the stars and out into the universe with his own eyes. And he meditated deeply upon that and thought about it and realized how that if you really understand that and you think about it with an open mind, you're going to see it's much more than just happenstance. Now, that was his view, and that's the biblical view. Time and time again, you can read that in the Bible. But there are all kinds of laws there. And God says in Matthew 13, verse 15, as I said last week, that their eyes they have closed. They have closed their eyes to God. And they don't allow Him in. Read those, most of the better scientific books about astronomy, and see how much they include God in the picture. They won't even allow for Him as a theory that it could possibly be that way, that He created all of that. Isaiah 45 and verse 18 says this, "For thus says the Eternal that created the heavens, God Himself that formed the earth, He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Eternal and there's none else." Now, if you put that verse with Hebrews 1 and Romans 8, you can see that not just the earth, but the whole universe was created to be inhabited. Now, that was God's plan. First, He had to create it for the angels to inhabit. Then, of course, they proved that they were not able to rule that universe, and so God decided that He had to have His own mind and His own character to be able to rule the universe under Him. So He recreated men with His own mind and His own character to to assure that that could be done, that that rule could be sustained. Notice what it says in Genesis 1 and verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, but then something happened between there and verse 2. And the earth became, it should read, became without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. So what happened between verse 1 and 2 is, it says in Isaiah 14, Ezekiel 28, that Lucifer rebelled and wrecked the universe and wrecked this earth. Now that's what your Bible says. And we have an Isaiah booklet that will explain that to you. And all of our literature is absolutely free. It costs you nothing. But notice what God did to the earth, but He didn't do it to the universe. Notice what He did to this earth. Psalm 104, verse 30, you send forth your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. He had to renew the face of the earth for man to be created and put on this earth. But it doesn't say He renewed the face of the universe or the heavens or the planets out in the universe. It doesn't say that because He didn't. Now that lawlessness of Satan the devil, that's what it was, caused him, or Lucifer, caused him to rebel against God. And a third of the angels, roughly anyhow, followed after him. But all the planets, you see, were not restored, but the earth was. And now the universe is in a state of decay and death. Now, God would never create it that way. It's unlike the earth. The universe is in decay and death. It's not like the earth. God would never leave it that way, though, because He says, you should become perfect as I am perfect, and He creates only imperfection. That is what God is. But the universe is in a state of death, frankly. That's the problem. But it says in Romans 8, verses 19 through 23 that I read last week, that the planets, or those heavens out there, are just groaning, God says. That's what it said, the word that's used in Romans. Just groaning for the liberty of the sons of God to be set free from that decay and death. The universe just groans. God personalizes that to try to help us understand what's going on out there. It's groaning and waiting for us to prepare and get ready to change all that and give the universe liberty and freedom and beauty and life. And that's exactly what we're going to do. If we obey God, God says that He'd give us a part in imparting life to those trillions and trillions of planets out in the universe. That's our future. But if you look at Romans 8, it really strongly implies and indicates that there is no life out in the universe, and yet the scientists keep looking for life. But if you look at the Bible, you can be almost certain, and I think I am certain, that there's no life out there. That's what Romans 8 is all about. It's groaning for life. And we're going to impart that life if we obey God now and get ready and prepare to be the bride of Jesus Christ and help Him to rule the earth. And then after Project Earth, then we move on to the universe. That it seems like endless universe. And maybe that's exactly what it is. But that is our potential. The universe is just groaning, and we're going to make it like the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden was only a type of what God is going to do to this earth and what He's going to do to the universe. It talks about Eden, the garden of God. He's going to make the whole universe one giant, gigantic garden. And maybe with a lot of life that we haven't even thought about yet might be created up there, as I'll show you a couple of scriptures in a moment. But that is the potential that we have to be able to go out there and beautify that endless universe. Now, that is just such an inspiring future that you can hardly contain yourself sometimes when you truly understand it. It is that wonderful. And it's for you. It is for you. It's for me. It's for us. God is going to give it to us to rule by recreating Himself in us, though. We have to let Him create His own mind and character in us, or we can't do that. We couldn't possibly do such a job. Now, of course, once God decided to recreate Himself in man, He had to be ready to sacrifice His Son for our inevitable sins, it would seem. And God then created His ultimate creation, Himself, creating Himself in man. And Jesus Christ was slain from the foundation of the world, from the time that Adam and Eve turned away from God and laid the foundation, as it were, for this world. Well, that was absolute death for Jesus Christ. Because God the Father and Jesus Christ want a family, and they want you in that family. That's what it's all about. Father and son, husband and bride, children. It's all about family. Now, that's a wonderful calling to be able to impart that life to this universe. That's exactly what we're going to do, and it may be beyond anything we could imagine. Let me read this to you. This is from Herbert Armstrong's Incredible Human Potential book. But he says, the picture showed clearly to us precisely what it revealed in the Word of God. Romans 8, verses 19 through 23, Revised Standard Version, all is waste, deterioration, and condition of decay. There appeared no evidence of any sign of life of any sort. No evidence of any sign of life of any sort that in those probes into space when Mr. Armstrong was alive. Not any sort of life was found. Well, I wonder if they ought to check the Bible before they get into those massively costly projects like that. And it costs many billions of dollars. But there's nothing that could sustain life. That's what Mr. Armstrong wrote. He said, all indications are that only our planet Earth is a life-supporting planet. Others appear to be like our moon, dead, decayed, wasted, and empty. So, you see, they have the wrong goals there for these space probes. In Isaiah 51 and verse 16, let me read that to you. And I have put my words in your mouth, and I have covered you in the shadow of my hand, that I may plant the heavens and lay the foundations of the earth, and say unto Zion, you are my people. You are my family. See, he says he's going to plant the heavens. Plant the heavens. With what? With life. And maybe they were planted that way before Lucifer's rebellion and Lucifer's destroyed all of it. It certainly wasn't created the way it is today. Your Bible makes that very clear. But here we are on this earth today to prepare for ruling this world with Christ and with God the Father. And then after the earth is perfected and made into a Garden of Eden, then we move on to the universe and make it into Eden, the Garden of God. The whole universe is going to be beautiful like that. You see, if we really understand God and His love and His might, we know that there has to be something really, really enormous if God has a plan. I mean, after all, if He created us and He created the universe, you know He has something really staggering in His mind that is staggering to us and perhaps even to Him in many ways. because he's recreating himself, and a God can't even do anything greater than that. Recreating himself. Do we really understand what that means, to have God recreate himself in us? There's nothing like that going on in this earth, and never will be anything like it. It's just a trillion miles ahead of any other idea anybody's ever had. But why do the heavens need to be planted? Could it be, you see, that there was something out there somewhat like the earth that God had already made, where he had created life there? Well, it doesn't say exactly what was there, but we know there was some kind of life there, because God says he's going to plant that universe, and he prepared it to be planted, and he made it beautiful, and Satan wrecked it, whatever was created out there. Satan destroyed this earth and made it an absolute horror picture. If you could see the condition of it there in Genesis 1 and verse 2. It reads like something out of a dark, black swamp of garbage and in a sewer and that type of thing. That's what it was, the condition he left it in. God restored it so that he could create man and finish the project out there in the universe that the angels didn't qualify to do. Now that is just amazing. Notice what it says in Hebrews 2 and verse 8. You have put all things in subjection under his feet, man's feet. For in that he, God, put all in subjection under him, man, he, God, left nothing that is not put under him. And the all things there, the Moffat says, is universe. God has put the whole universe under man. But notice what it says in verse 5, but now we see not yet all things, the endless universe it is talking about, put under him. See, it's not yet, because we have to get prepared to be ready for that and qualify for that. His wife has made herself ready, it says in Revelation 19 and verse 7. Then verse 8 it says, talking about the world to come, But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, or for a little while lower, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor. See, crowned with glory and honor. Christ has already been crowned with glory and honor, and he says we're going to be joint heirs with him. That's what the scripture says. The very elect are going to be joint heirs, so we're created for glory as well, the same glory that Christ has already received. Notice it says in verses 10 and 11, for it became him for whom are all things, that is the entire universe, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons into glory to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering, for which cause he, Christ, is not ashamed to call them brethren. He's not ashamed to call you sons and daughters. Not at all. See, he's already inherited the universe, and we're going to do the same. I just want to give you one last scripture here in James 1 and verse 17. It says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. And when he's talking about lights there, he's talking about the universe. He created all that. He's the Father of lights. He's the Father of all that fabulous creation out there in the universe. But notice what he says in verse 18, and this ought to really cause you to pause and hesitate and ponder your future. Verse 18, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. See, we are first fruits. of His creatures. In other words, sons of God called out ahead of time to prepare to help Christ rule and bring the rest of humanity into God's family. See, the big issue is not the universe in all of its fabulous glory, but what God is really concerned about is recreating Himself and creating sons of God to enter into His family. That's what's really important. The material universe, well, it's just that, material, physical stuff. And He's going to create sons that can actually go out there and create a universe. That is your future. That is what God has called us to do. And I'll tell you, that's what's really important. And when you consider everything man has received today, those pictures from the Hubble telescope, and all they see out in that universe, and all they understand about all these different features here on this earth, I say that scientists who do not bring God into the picture are showing the ultimate contempt for God. They're without excuse. They've always been without excuse. But how about in this end time, when we have all of those mind-dazzling pictures that the Hubble has given us about this majestic universe, and yet we still won't bring God into the picture? That's a sad, sad state of affairs today. Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.
Request our free booklet, Isaiah's End Time Vision, and our free correspondence course lesson on the purpose of mankind. Isaiah has a powerful vision for the Laodiceans, the nations of Israel, and even the whole world. You won't find a more inspiring, far-reaching vision in all the Bible. It pictures a beautiful and peaceful earth. The vision reaches out into the universe. This prophet also reveals how Satan successfully destroys that vision for many of God's own people. Those who overcome Satan's deception will be the most honored people ever on this earth. They will become the bride of Christ. Request our free booklet, Isaiah's End Time Vision, and our free correspondence course lesson on the purpose of mankind. This is just one of the lessons in our correspondence course series. You can also enroll in our Bible correspondence course for free. Also ask for a free subscription to our monthly news magazine, The Philadelphia Trumpet. Don't miss our newest issue with Gerald Fleury's article, You Can Overcome Fear. Also, visit us online at thetrumpet.com for daily columns and news update videos. There you'll see our From the Editor section, which includes weekly web-exclusive videos from Key of David presenter Gerald Fleury. Request our free booklet, Isaiah's End Time Vision, and our free correspondence course lesson on the purpose of mankind. You'll also be sent a free subscription to The Trumpet magazine. All our literature is free and will be sent to you with no cost or obligation. Order your free literature now.